In the last lectures, we have looked at statistical estimation problems. We have a family of distributions that is described by a parameter, and our goal is to estimate this parameter. The only examples we've done so far were very simple examples where you want to estimate the mean of the distribution or the variance or something like that. Now the problem is, in machine learning, we rarely want to estimate, it's also nice to estimate the mean, but typically we want to estimate something that is much more complicated. And then it is very difficult to write down immediately what a closed form solution for your estimate is. And sometimes you can still write down a closed form, but it is not so obvious to derive the closed form. And I want to start with an example. I can't resist, it comes from a paper we published last year. It's called Net Gun Without Gun. And here the scenario is the following. So assume we are given a graph. And so in our case, the statistical model consists of all kinds of graphs. So this is the set of n times n matrices. I write maybe A matrix A. A is symmetric. The entries are all aij are either 0 or 1. And this is supposed to be intuition, the adjacency matrix of a graph. I just write adjacency matrix the adjacency matrices of graphs, say of size n. Maybe I write A symmetric, it should be an n times n matrix, so n is known. And it's supposed to be the adjacency matrix of a graph. So the idea is, in the background we have somewhere graphs here, social network, or brain graph, or a climate graph, whatever scientific phenomenon you want to look at, and that can be modeled by a graph. So assume we have a brain graph, to make it concrete, 100 vertices that symbolize different regions in the brain, and some edges if these regions in the brain talk to each other, something like that. And now our sampling is something complicated, because here there's nothing random yet so far. So A is sort of, that's the parameterization. We know that there's a graph in the background, but we don't know it. Now what we observe is, we observe random walks from this graph. And maybe to explain that, I don't want to go into the detail, but I just give you the intuition. So you have a graph. It has certain edges, it's in this case an unweighted graph, edges are either 0 or 1. And a random walk is now a process that starts, it selects a starting vertex, one of the vertices in the graph, say this guy, according to some distribution. And then it randomly jumps to one of the neighbors. So here it has four different choices, you throw a die, and it says, you maybe I need to go here. Now you sit here, you have three choices, you throw a die with probability 1/3 for each of the edges, and then maybe you jump here, and so on. So this is a random walk on the graph. And now observe, now we assume that all we can observe about our graph are random walks. So we observe maybe k random walks from the graph of length, I don't know, 10. This is just an example. So for k times, I do this process, I select a starting vertex randomly, do k steps according to my random walk, and I produce the sequence of vertices that I have seen. So I have, so one random walk is maybe, is a sequence, so one random walk produces a sequence xn, x1, x2, to x10, which tells us on which vertices it is visited. Sequence of vertices. Okay? And the vertices have names, so this is vertex 1, vertex 2, vertex 3, and so on. So one random walk produces one such sequence, and now you observe a second one, a third one, and so on, until you have seen k such random walks. And now your goal is to reconstruct what the graph was. What is A? So the goal is reconstruct, or in statistical terms, estimate A. Okay? And this is now a typical problem as it occurs in machine learning. So we're not in a parametric setting where the parameter space is just the mean of a distribution and we know everything is normally distributed. We have something really complicated going on. We have a matrix. So our probability distributions, essentially, I mean, the probability distributions give us random walks, but they're indexed by an adjacency matrix. So this whole, like such a distribution has n square many parameters, and the question is now, how could you estimate it? Now you could think, okay, maybe I can write a closed form for my estimate A, but maybe it is not so obvious. And if you spend a week, maybe you figure even out how you might write down a closed form solution for A. But the typical thing you now do in machine learning is what is called the maximum likelihood approach. And intuitively, the maximum likelihood approach is to ask which adjacency matrix A is most likely to have produced the random walks that I have observed. So you have these random walks in front of you. You look at all the adjacency matrices and you say, well, is it likely that this adjacency matrix has produced these random walks? You look at it and maybe say, no, that's really unlikely. And then you look at another adjacency matrix and say, well, that's maybe also not so likely. And you look at a third adjacency matrix, and then you say, that already looks more plausible. And in which way do you judge the plausibility? You judge it by how likely is it that the random walks that you have seen have been produced from this particular graph. Okay? And such an approach is called the maximum likelihood approach. And this occurs all over the place in machine learning, but is benign as than all these estimates we've seen before. So let us try to formalize it. Maybe as just for the keeping notes, I write example here, construct estimate A, and then I write idea. So select among all adjacency matrices, so this, in this case, it's just finitely many, it's an n times n matrix and the entries are 0, 1, so you should know how many matrices there are, a lot, but finitely many. Select among all adjacency A in F, select the one that has the highest likelihood to have produced the random walks you have observed. And if you try to do that by hand, you could already start thinking about it maybe for a second and observe that if a random walk goes between vertex A and vertex B, but the adjacency matrix, a certain adjacency matrix has a zero edge there, then it already can't be the true adjacency matrix because a random walk can only walk along edges that are there in the graph. So by seeing which edges the random walk took, you can already rule out all the adjacency matrices that do not have all these edges. But then maybe depending on how many random walks you have seen, that might not be enough, and then you need to be a bit more clever. Okay. And so this is what is called the maximum likelihood approach. And now we're going to do it a bit more formally. More formally. So we consider a parametric family call it F theta in some space capital theta and observe data points, IID points, x1 to xn, according to some function f which is in the set. And we don't know which one, and we want to find out which one. Maybe I just write instead of this, I just write 2f theta in f. Okay, and now for simplicity, assume that we have densities here, that these f theta are really densities. And now what we do is typically we write down the likelihood of the data given the parameter. So the likelihood of the data given a parameter. This can be now some parameter theta null, it doesn't need to be, of course, the true one. Is now, so if you want, it is p theta of x1 xn. Now this is in a discrete case, this is of course a quantity that is well defined, or, well, the question is now how you really write this down formally. I don't want to spend so much time on formalism. So what I mean by this is that if you look at the probability measure with respect to the true parameter, and this is now parameter theta 0, so we have here a theta 0, and we evaluate the parameter, the probability with respect to this theta 0, or the probability of observing x1 to xn. Now, if you have a density, then instead of looking at the probability, you might maybe want to look at the density, but I don't want to go so much into it. I first of all want to show you what is the concept here. And this is now, there's a different way of writing this, which is much more common. People typically write the probability of x1, xn, given theta. And this is now a bit of an abuse of notation because, well, I'm not sure whether it's abuse of notation, but it suggests that theta might be a random variable, which it is not. But essentially, this is the condition, the theta, and theta 0, it needs to be theta 0. It says, under the condition that we have the parameter theta 0, the probability of the sample points we have observed is a certain number, and this is what we mean here. And this is the likelihood. So the likelihood in statistics, in machine learning, and also in Bayesian statistics is always the probability of the data given the set of parameters that we have. Okay, and now because we have, because our data points are supposed to be IID, we can also write this as a product from I to N. The product of the probabilities of xi given theta 0. Okay? So this is the likelihood of the data if theta 0 was really the true parameter. And now the maximum likelihood approach is simply we want to maximize that, and we want to pick the parameter theta that maximizes this expression. So how do I write this? I write it on the next page. To estimate the true parameter theta, we now select theta hat, so this is going to be our estimate, such that this likelihood is maximized. And how does it look formally? So theta hat is defined to be the argmax over all theta in our parameter space theta of the probability of observing x1 to xn given theta. Okay, so this is really simple as a, or the concept is really simple. Now observe that you can also rewrite this if you want, so we can now replace this and say it's the argmax of this product here of the probabilities xi given theta, and the product goes over I and the argmax goes over theta. And sometimes what often helps now is to maximize this product is computationally always a bit of a nightmare, because all these probabilities are really small and you're multiplying many, many numbers that are really small. So it happens very soon that you run into numerical problems because your number are too small. So typically what people do is they look at the log likelihood. So this is equivalent to the problem, so theta hat is argmax of log of this probability, log of this whole probability p of xi given theta. Because the log function is monotonously increasing, so whether you maximize the probability itself or log of the probability doesn't really matter. And now this can be written a bit more conveniently. Now, of course, you have a log and a product, so you can take out the product out in terms of a sum. So this is argmax of the sum of I equals 1 to n of log of p of xi given theta. And now, so this is a number that is between 0 and 1. So the log of this number, if you write it like this, is negative. It's smaller than 0. Because the log of a number that is smaller than 1 is smaller than 0, this is a bit annoying. And then often people say we look at the negative log likelihood because this is then a positive number. So which is equivalent? Which is equivalent to minimizing the negative log likelihood. And this is now theta hat is arg min over the thetas sum I equals 1 to n negative log likelihood. And now this is a number that is larger than 0. So this is, it's just a bit more, it's more convenient to have a minimization problem because most of the optimization packages simply minimize and don't maximize. So you need to transform it into a minimization problem anyways, and then you have positive numbers here. So there's nothing deep going on. And so this is the maximum likelihood approach. Now, of course, depending on your model, it might be easy or not so easy to solve it. So maybe I write first. So this is the maximum likelihood approach, and maybe I should continue in red. Sometimes. This optimization problem is easy. So observe, this is now an optimization problem. We have a parameter space theta and we need to find the parameter theta that maximizes the likelihood. So this is a typical optimization problem. And we're going to talk about optimization later in this lecture. If it's a continuous problem, and maybe if we're lucky it is even nice, then we can solve it and easily. And if we're really, really lucky, we could even solve it analytically. In most cases, you can't, it's not convex. If you're lucky, it's continuous, or if you should try to achieve that it's continuous, and then you need to solve it by some optimization solver, like Adam or whatever software you're using. So let's continue here. Sometimes the optimization problem is easy. It might be able to solve it analytically. And I'm going to show you an example in a minute, but this is rare. So I think for whatever you're going to encounter in machine learning, if it's not in one of the standard statistics frameworks, don't try to do that. You can try. And how do you do that? You have a function, you want to optimize it. You take the derivative with respect to your parameter, you set it to zero, you solve that, and maybe you find it. And we're going to see an example. Sometimes if you're lucky, it is convex, and you can then solve it easily with a convex solver, but most typically, it is neither, it is not convex. And the problem which I've started with in the beginning turns out like if, of course, there are still many model choices we need to make in which kind of loss function you use and so on, but the way we used it then was a continuous problem but not a convex one. Okay. Now I want to show you one example where we can solve it analytically. Oops, how do I get this away? Example analytic. Analytic solution. But as I said, this is more for demonstration purposes of the principle. This is nothing you would hope for in practice. So we assume now, we look at Poisson distributed random variables. And a Poisson distribution is something that models a random, a discrete random process with rare events. So for example, you want to know the number of customers that enter your shop within the next hours. So the random variable is always when like essentially you count how many customers you have, and there's a parameter lambda that tells you essentially what is the intensity of this process. So you could count customers, you could also look at like radioactive particles and the decay, like how many particles decay in a certain amount of time and so on, and all this is being modeled by a Poisson distribution. And now how it works is the following. So x, I just write it as Poisson with parameter lambda, and this means that the probability that x is x is, now this is simply the formula lambda to the power of x e to the minus lambda x factorial. Okay, so this is just one of the, this is a typical distribution that's well known in probability theory. It looks complicated, but after all, it's not such a complicated thing. And it has, maybe it has, that the expectation of x is lambda. So the expected number of radioactive particles which decay is lambda. And finally, it also has the variance of x is also lambda. This is just a curious coincidence here. And now we observe random variables according to this Poisson distribution. So this is our statistical model. So the model is this one. Now we observe x1 to xn according to this Poisson distribution. But we don't know lambda, of course. And now we want to estimate it. To construct the maximum likelihood ML estimator. So in machine learning, ML either means machine learning or it means maximum likelihood. In this case, it means maximum likelihood. Okay, now how does it work? We now write down what is the likelihood. So sometimes people write this L of x1 to xn as the likelihood. So this is the probability of x1, no, sorry, that's not true. That's the likelihood of the parameter. The likelihood for the parameter is the probability of observing x1 to xn given that lambda is the true parameter. Now again, we have independence, so this is the same as the product of, and now comes the formula. So this is lambda of xi e to the minus lambda divided by xi factorial. Now we can take the log of this probability, so log of this whole expression is now the same as, now we take the log of this guy, and the product becomes a sum. So this is sum I equals 1 to n of the log of, and now comes this fraction, lambda to the power of xi e to the minus lambda xi factorial. Maybe I write a parenthesis. And now let's maybe simplify that. We leave the sum I equals 1 to n. Now the log of a ratio is, we can write log of denominator minus log of numerator. No, numerator is the thing on top. Log of numerator minus log of denominator, and then we have a product here on top. We can also take, this is going to give us a plus, so we can take it apart as follows. So log of, maybe I first write it down and then we look at it. Sum of xi log lambda minus lambda minus log xi factorial. Okay, so what happened here is now, this is minus log xi factorial is this guy, and here we have the log of this. I can write it as xi log lambda, and the log of this guy is, so I need to write plus log of this guy, and the log of this guy is minus lambda, and this is the minus lambda here. Okay. So this is the log likelihood. And now we need to compute the maximum of this log likelihood. We need to optimize it. So now we take the derivative. Now we want to optimize for lambda. So the important thing is we now take the derivative of this expression with respect to lambda, because this is the one in which we want to find a minimum or maximum. So we are still with, so we want to find a maximum in this formulation. So the way this looks like is maybe roughly, I don't know, like this. And this is the point we want to find. This is the log likelihood. Okay, and here's lambda. So we take the derivative. Maybe I call this whole expression here f of lambda. And then I want to now compute f prime. So the derivative of f with respect to lambda is now, so we keep the sum. Now the derivative of log is 1 over the thing, and the factor remains. So this is xi over lambda. Then here the derivative is just minus 1. And here this expression luckily doesn't involve any lambda, so we can, it simply disappears in the derivative, which is good because you don't want to look at the derivative of a factorial also. So this is the sum goes from I equals 1 to n. And now you can rewrite this. The lambda is just a factor that you can pull out. It is 1 over lambda times sum I equals 1 to n xi minus 1. Okay, and this is supposed to be 0 because we want to set the derivative to 0. So let's did I make a mistake here? So my notes here say n times lambda. Oh yes, I made a mistake. Maybe some of you have noticed it. So this lambda here of course occurs inside the sum. So we have n times lambda here. And so then the derivative here, instead of the minus 1, I need to write minus n. Minus n. And here as well, it needs to be minus n. I hope that's clear. If not, do it yourself until it's clear. And now we need to solve this equation. Sometimes I need to verify that everything is still correct. I was confused, but I think it's correct. So what we solve this equation. Now finally, if we solve the equation, what we obviously find is lambda is 1 over n times the sum of I equals 1 to n xi. Okay, so we multiply the equation by n. then here on the right-hand side nothing happens, but on the left-hand side we get lambda times n, and then we solve for lambda, and that's it. Okay, so this is now our maximum likelihood estimate. So, okay, now we need, okay, I skip a bit of steps here, so this is now, the derivative is zero, we now need to check whether this is really a maximum, and whether it's also the global maximum and all these kind of things. I don't want to bother with it, but this is going to, if you do all that, it works well, and you find that this is really the maximum of the function. So the conclusion is, so lambda hat defined as 1 over n sum I equals 1 to n xi is the maximum likelihood estimate of lambda. Okay, and now this has been computed analytically. Now in this particular example, that's sort of an outcome that is good, because I've already said that lambda is also the mean of your random variable, and now this, if you look at it, it's just the estimate for the sample mean, so that makes perfect sense. But it is not always clear that the maximum likelihood estimate is going to give you the estimate that you're after. So, I mean, in this case, knowing the Poisson distribution and knowing you want to estimate lambda, and it's the expectation, you could have said right away, well, we just use the sample mean as our estimate and we're fine. But now you also know that this is also the maximum likelihood estimate, which is not always true. You could, I mean, and for example, we could also say lambda is also the variance, so we could also estimate lambda by the sample variance. This would not correspond to the maximum likelihood estimate. So as I said, there are often many different ways in which you can estimate, and the maximum likelihood estimate is just one of them. And then hopefully it has nice properties. In this particular case, it's really nice because we can compute it analytically. In practice, this is rarely the case. Okay. Now I want to make a couple of more comments. So the maximum likelihood estimate is often nice, but not always, from a theoretical perspective. And there are certain properties that people tend to look at. And I want to simply tell you about the fact that these things exist, if you're interested, and you need to look it up in the literature. So from the theory side, so this is the end of the example. So from the theory side, the maximum likelihood estimate, MLE, often, but not always, has nice properties. Okay, so the first one is that often the maximum likelihood estimate gives you a consistent estimate. In the last lecture we said an estimate is consistent if the estimate ultimately converges to the true value of the parameter that we're looking at. And the maximum likelihood estimate often does that. So if the model F consists of nice functions, and I don't even want to specify this. By nice functions, I mean densities that are smooth and have nice properties. They are simply nice in a certain sense, in sense they satisfy certain conditions that you need for the proof. If the model consists of nice functions, then the maximum likelihood estimate based on an IID sample is consistent. Okay, so maybe as a side remark, something that also pops up here as a side effect, in fact, is of course this depends on the model F, because we optimize our maximum likelihood estimator over the space of parameters, over all possible parameters. And now in many models, in machine learning and also in real world, you might have different parameter spaces that are plausible. And so what is a maximum likelihood estimate depends on your choice of functions that you find plausible. And your choice of functions has a strong influence, of course, on the outcome. So if you choose a different space of functions, then you get a different maximum likelihood estimate. And this is where your prior knowledge about the world needs to go into the problem somehow. So, maximum likelihood often is consistent. And then one other thing, the maximum likelihood, the error of the maximum likelihood estimate often is normally distributed. And this is something that's really cool because we then can even construct confidence sets. Let me write this down. So if f again consists of nice functions, then the maximum likelihood estimate, the MLE estimate, now I call it zeta ML, zeta hat MLE, is what is called asymptotically normal. And asymptotically normal means, let me write it down, so you look at the maximum likelihood estimate minus the true parameter and you rescale it by the standard error. So remember, the standard error is the variance, is the standard deviation. No. The standard error is the standard deviation of the maximum likelihood estimate. The standard error is the standard deviation of the estimate. The variance of the estimate is the variance, and standard error is the square root of that. So this expression converges in distribution to a standard normal distribution. And the same holds true, in fact, for the estimated standard error. I write also end theta MLE hat minus theta over the estimated standard error also converges in distribution to the standard normal distribution. And this is really nice because now we have quantities that we sort of, I mean, we don't know the theta, but we know the maximum likelihood estimate, and we might even be, I mean, sometimes at least be able to estimate its variance. I mean, in the simplest case, by simply repeating it often and simply measuring what the variance is, and then we know that it converges to a normal distribution. And this then helps us to construct confidence interval. Maybe why is this the case? I mean, things typically in converge, and of course this holds as n goes to infinity, right? I mean, the convergence is in terms of n, the number of sample points. And why that is this plausible? Because if we look back to the maximum likelihood estimate, a maximum likelihood estimate always has the form, it is the sum of lots of independent random variables. So the xi's are independent here, so this is an independent random variable, and sums of independent random variables, of course, converge to normal distributions. So hidden here somewhere is a central limit theorem. The fact that log likelihood is a sum of independent random variables makes it plausible that this estimate might converge. Of course, the proof is a bit more involved, but here is the intuition. And now the third thing is this helps us to construct confidence intervals. This can be used to construct confidence intervals. And now maybe I write it down first and then give you the intuition. So we define Cn as the interval. So we have the maximum likelihood estimate minus, and then let me first write it down, z alpha over 2 s e hat, and then the same with plus theta m l e hat plus z alpha over 2. Sorry, I need to write it nicer. Z alpha over 2 s e hat. Where, I first write it down and then give you the explanation, where z alpha 2 is, I just write it down, phi to the minus 1 of 1 minus alpha half. Okay, now I need to give many explanations for what all this means. So, first of all, phi is the cumulative of the normal distribution. This is the CDF of in 0, 1. This is a standard notation. Phi is always, in statistics, phi is always the cumulative of the normal distribution. Now what happens here is we have a normal distribution, a standard normal distribution like this, and we have its cumulative. It looks maybe like this, la la la, so. Okay. And now we look at, so alpha is again the parameter of confidence that we want to have for our confidence interval. And now we look at alpha over 2. So alpha might be 5%, and then we look for 1 minus 2.5%, so this might be alpha over 2 here. And the trick is now, so here is alpha over 2 as well. And so we choose this alpha over 2 such that the cumulative at this point, sorry, this is z alpha over 2. And it is chosen in such a way that the cumulative here is 1 minus alpha 2. So this means, and this is what we're in fact after, if we look at the tail of this distribution, it has mass alpha over 2. Okay? And this is essentially the place where it is supposed to go wrong. So what we now do here is, maybe I also plot it here on the other side of the normal distribution. Here we also have mass alpha 2. Alpha over 2. So these blue regions are the ones where hopefully the true guy does not sit. So remember, the confidence set is constructed in a way that the true parameter theta hopefully sits, or with 95% probability is supposed to sit inside this. Now here we have a situation where we know this maximum likelihood estimate, it has mean, well, it's an estimate, and the standard deviation, and this is essentially the standard, like the standard deviation of the, it's a factor, we multiply by the factor to stretch the normal distribution, because these z's here are computed according to the normal distribution n0, 1. And now when we introduce this factor, standard estimate, we have the standard deviation of n0 se hat. And now this z means that alpha half gives us essentially this epsilon. So it essentially now says, so this is how, now I need yet another color, green. So this is essentially the minus epsilon, and this is the plus epsilon that we need to have to construct a confidence set. So we have our estimate. So now let's draw one more figure. So here we have theta mle hat. And now we introduce plus epsilon under minus epsilon. So this whole thing is going to be our confidence set. And now the hope is that the true parameter sits inside this confidence interval set with probability 1 minus alpha. And this happens because we have the normal distribution here and we know that this parameter is distributed in this way. Okay. If you don't see that right now, my suggestion is to think about it for a minute. Maybe it takes a bit of time to digest what's really going on here. And now, so maybe I've written down now what the confidence interval construction is, and these are now approximate confidence intervals, because, of course, like if we go back, this statement here is just, this statement here just says, ultimately as n gets very large, then the distribution of this guy converges to a normal distribution. And then, so this only holds approximately. So what I want to say here, Cn is an approximate confidence interval, in the sense that the probability of theta, so under the true parameter theta, the probability that this true parameter really sits in Cn converges to 1 minus alpha as n goes to infinity. Okay. And so this is of course a nice property because, I mean, at least it means if we are in a nice scenario where the underlying model consists of nice functions, then we can, first of all, I mean, assume we are able to compute this maximum likelihood estimate. We know it's consistent in the sense that it really converges as n goes to infinity to the right solution. But we also know it is asymptotically normally distributed, so we can even construct confidence sets for this distribution, for this estimate, and this is something that's really valuable in practice. And we're also going to see that later in the lecture about testing, for example, where constructing a test is essentially more or less the same as constructing a confidence interval for an estimate.